This presentation will include practical information of the privacy peer survey techniques. I will try to explain how to implement several privacy techniques in your implementations, in your information systems. Hopefully, by the end of my talk, you will know what is data privacy, how you can prevent your data privately, and how to do several computation over encrypted sensitive data. In this talk also, I will try to give lots of technical information about the data privacy techniques. I know that it is impossible to learn every privacy preserving techniques, but in one presentation, my aim when I prepare this presentation is to give inspiration for the data privacy techniques. Maybe you can get some keywords from this presentation at the end of my presentation. Then you can Google it to these keywords to learn insights and details of these techniques. After my talk, there will be a time for discussion and questions. But if you have questions, please interrupt me. Okay. Let me start my presentation. My talk will be in five parts. In the first part, I will try to give the definition of the data privacy, what is data privacy, etc. Then in the second part, I will give the perturbation-based data privacy. I will give some information about what is suppress, what is masking, what is generalization in these techniques, and the practical implementation also. In the third part, I will share the statistical perturbation-based differential privacy techniques. Then I will try to change the data privacy from perturbation perspective to the encryption domain. In section four, I will give the detail of the homomorphic encryption, the definition, the types of the homomorphic encryption, and the practical implementation of the homomorphic encryption algorithms. And the last part, I will give the detail of the order preserving encryption techniques, which can be used for the cloud system, again, to protect the privacy while providing the preservation for the SQL queries. Okay, let me start with the definition of the data privacy. What is data privacy? It's a broad term, but we can conclude as it is a branch of data security concerned with the proper handling of data. This includes how data should be collected, stored, and shared with any third parties, as well as compliance with the applicable privacy laws. As you know, there are some privacy rules, especially in Europe, GDPR, etc. And also, there is a confliction between data security and data privacy. They are not exactly the same. To properly protect data and comply with data protection laws, you need both data privacy and data security, even though these two terms can look similar. Let me continue with the definition of data privacy and data security and their differences. Data security, it regards the means of protection that an organization is taking in order to prevent any third party from unauthorized access to digital data. It focuses on the protection of data from malicious attacks and prevents the exploitation of the stolen data for data breach or cybersecurity attacks. On the other hand, data privacy, it focuses on the right of individuals or right of humans, people, to purpose of data collection and processing, privacy preference, and the way organization govern personal data and data subjects. Okay, let me check my notes. Okay. And let's continue with the privacy enhanced technologies. or PIT shortly. PIT allows online users to protect the privacy of their personal identifiable information provided and handled by the services and applications. PIT uses techniques to minimize the possession of personal data without losing the functionality of an information system. We can divide the privacy-enhanced technology into two subgroups. The first one is soft privacy technologies, and the other one is hard privacy technologies. If the third party is trusted entity for the processing of data, then we can apply soft privacy technologies, such as access controls, differential privacy, or tunnel-based encryption, such as SSL TLS protocols. But if the third party cannot be trusted, then we have to use hard privacy technologies, such as homomorphic encryption, secure multi-party computation, or order-based encryption technologies. So let's move to data analytics. The use of data analytics by the companies is enhancing every year. The primary focus of the companies is on customers and users. And data analysis is an internal function which is done by the data analyst through presenting numbers and figures to the management. It involves a more detailed approach in recording, analyzing, disseminating, and presenting data findings. As you see in this figure, there are four different groups for privacy analytics. The first one is surveillance. Based on the opinion data and sentiment analysis, social media sites does provide recommendation of the new friends, place to visit, or people to follow, etc. This is possible only when they continues to monitor their customer transactions. The second trait is disclosure. Let's consider a hospital holding patients' data, including zip code, gender information, age information, and disease or illness. The third-party data analyst can map this information with a freely available external data sources like census data and can identify person suffering with some disorder, some illness. The third trait is discrimination. It can happen when some private information of a person is disclosed. For instance, statistical analysis of electoral results proved that people of one community were completely against the party which is formed the government. So there can be a discrimination for these peoples. And the last trait is personal or personal embracement and abuse. For example, a person was privately undergoing medication for some specific problem and was buying some medicine from the regular basis from the medical shop. As a part of their regular business model, the medical shop may send some reminder and offers related to the these medicines over phone. If any family member has noticed this, it will be lead a personal embracement and even abuse. Okay. Let's continue with the. Come to the next point, which is data perturbation-based data privacy. This is the first type of the data privacy. Before starting these methods, I want to clarify one misunderstanding about the anonymization techniques. Let's discuss this question. How do you publicly release a database or data set without compromising individual privacy? The wrong answer is just leave out any unique identifiers like name or social security number or something like that. Hope that this works. No, it will not work. We need some mathematical models to protect the data. The first approach is perturbation-based techniques. So there are three techniques for the data perturbation. K anonymity, L diversity, and T closeness. Let's start with the K anonymity. This is the first approach. In K anonymity, the attributes are suppressed or generalized until each row is identical with at least K different, K number of key rows. At this point, data set is K anonymous. There is an example table in here, as you see. We want to convert this table into the K is equal to anonymity. So in order to generalize or suppress this data set, we need to change the H column. Maybe we can divide it into two sections. Who is younger than 50, who is older than 50. And also, if it is meaningless for the data analysis, we can suppress the gender information. And also, lastly, we can suppress the last two characters of the zip codes, as you see in here, to create two anonymity. What is two anonymity? As you see, there is three groups in this data set. So each group at least two rows, as you see in here. The first group has two rows. The second row, has two rows, and the last group has two rows also. If we continue with the feature types in the anonymity, just for anonymity, K anonymity, for all anonymity methods. The first feature is key features. Key features can identify a person directly. The example of the key features are name, social security numbers, or your country's ID number. In order to prevent data, in order to protect the privacy in the dataset, you have to remove these fields. Remove or hide. The second type is quasi-identifiers. The quasi-identifiers can be linked to the external data to identify the person. For example, the example quasi-identifiers are zip code, city information, birthday, and gender information. In order to protect the privacy, we need to generalize or suppress these columns, this information. And the last one is sensitive data. We will not remove the sensitive data because we will use this sensitive data to build, for example, an analytics platform. So our aim is to cut the linkage between sensitive data and the individual information. So this example sensitive information is income and disease movement. The relationship with the person should be cut off. Okay. Let's continue with another example table. As you see in this table, the key feature is name. We have to remove this column. Quasi identifiers are in here, birth, gender information, and zip code. And the sensitive information is disease. Okay, let's continue with the practical implementation of the anonymity. In this slide, I will try to show how to implement the K-anonymity using Python and Pandas library. This is an example dataset, which is census income dataset. It's freely available on the internet. The dataset is generally used to predict whether income exceeds 50,000 in a year based on census data. And also, in fact, there are some other columns in the dataset, but it's a very huge table. So I choose only four columns: age, gender, origin, and income columns. Okay, let's continue. Okay. Let me show the differences between the original table and the suppressed table. This is the original table. So If you are familiar with Python and Pandas, you can use some lambda function in order to generalize the columns. In this example, I suppress the gender information because it is meaningless for this data analysis. So I remove all gender information and I replace it only star. So, and also I create a lookup table for the age information. In the original table, there's an exact age information. So I convert it to the young, middle, older, quite older, something like that. So, and this is the new output table. Let us check it is compatible with the k is equal to 5 anonymity. Okay. If we group by this output table, we can see some groups which has less than 5 rows. So our aim is to create groups which has at least 5 rows. So these results are the problematic results. For example, the first group has only one record, the second one has only two records, and etc. So we need to suppress one more column to provide a privacy-preserving version of the input table. So I used I converted the origin information for US and non-US. I also create the lambda function in here. If X is United States, it is US, else it will be non-US. After converting this column, I check the table again. There is no result. So our final table is K is compatible with the K anonymity. Implementation, example implementation. So let's continue with the problems. The key anonymity approach. Sometimes, and not always, sometimes key anonymization does not provide the exact privacy because the sensitive values sometimes do not vary in a class table or, yes, a class table. If attacker has some prior knowledge, then he can extract some sensitive information from the anonymized table. Let me show you how we can be. This is an example anonymized table, a three anonymized patient table. Let's say there is an attacker, and attacker has some information about the Bob. Attacker knows the Bob's zip code and Bob's age information. So by using these two information, and also attacker has some access to anonymized table, so he can get this information. Attacker doesn't know which row belongs to his Bob, but attacker's aim is to extract Bob's disease. So there is, as you see, there is no differentiation in the output label. So attacker can conclude that Bob has a heart disease. So, sometimes K anonymity is not enough to protect the privacy. So there is another technique, L diversity, in order to overcome this problem. In the L diversity, there will be at least L different sensitive data. In order to create a L diversity, firstly divide into the disease-based sub data set, as you see in here, and then create a new anonymized table with at least three, for example, in this example, three different records with three different label information. Okay, let's move on to differential privacy. It's perturbation based, of course, but not on the record level. Differential privacy protects the user privacy by adding some random info to the original data. For example, adding 3 years to your age while answering the survey protects the information. Okay, I want to provide some example scenario with you. For example, imagine if I am a data collector and I like to learn how many in this meeting have broken the law before. If I ask these questions to you, you might think this is a sensitive information and you may not to share with me. So let's do a little exercise to see maybe you are more willing to do so. In your head, pick a random number, for example, X. So between 1 to 10. If this number is odd, then when I ask this question, you have to answer truthfully. On the other hand, if I answer or your random number is even, then think of a second random number. If your head between 1 and 10. If the second random number is odd, then regardless of your true answer, just say yes. Also, if the second random number is even, then answer is no. Okay, so what's happening then? But there is a lot of randomness, as you see in here. So the result of the survey will be 50% of the time we get truth, 25% yes, and 25% no. Okay, let me continue with the homomorphic encryption. This is another point. Previous techniques are perturbation-based techniques, but now we will use the encryption-based data privacy techniques. The purpose of the homomorphic encryption is to make some computation over on encrypted data. Data remain confidential while it processing in an untrusted environment. The biggest example for the untrusted environments is cloud systems. So maybe you want to share your data in the cloud system to make some computation over your data, but you don't trust the cloud system. For this situation, homomorphic encryption is the best solution to solve the privacy problems. Let's continue with the definition of the homomorphic encryption and homomorphism. Homomorphism is a structure-preserving map between two algebraic structures. It describes the transformation of one dataset into another while preserving relationship between elements in the both sets. And these are the two Greek words, homomorphic, the same structure. What is the difference between the traditional encryption and homomorphic encryption? Homomorphic encryption allows computation to be performed directly on encrypted data without requiring access to secret key or without requiring access to plain version of the data. The result of such a computation remains in encrypted form and can at a later point be revealed by the owner of the secret key. Let's continue with the properties of the homomorphic encryption. The first one is no trusted third parties. Data in the homomorphic encryption, data remains secure and private in untrusted environments, in cloud system, for example. Data stays encrypted at all times, which minimizes the likelihood that sensitive information ever gets compromised. The second property is trade-off between data usability and data privacy. In the homomorphic encryption, there is no need to mask or drop any feature in order to preserve the privacy of the data. All features may be used in analysis without compromising the privacy. If you are familiar with the machine learning or data analysis tools, if you compress or if you remove the data from the original data set, your final model or your final classification model, let's say, classification models performance, classification performance will decrease. But in homomorphic encryption, you will get exactly the same result with the plain data. And the last one, property is quantum safe. Especially full homomorphic encryption crypto system are resilient against quantum attacks. Let's continue. Yes, there are some limitations for the homomorphic encryption. The first thing is poor performance. You are doing your arithmetic operations over encrypted data, so you need to wait some execution time. Homomorphic encryption has slow computation speed, especially for the fully homomorphic encryption. So fully homomorphic encryption remains problematic for computationally heavy applications. And also the second drawback is large memory consumption compared to plain text operations, making them sometimes impractical for the database queries. Okay, I want to show you a simple, it's not implementation, but simple, demonstration of the homomorphic encryption, multiplicative homomorphic encryption. So, in this demonstration, our aim is to create a privacy-preserving version of the array calculator for a rectangle. As you know, the rectangle array of the rectangle is a multiplication of width and height. So there are two entities in this demonstration. The first one is private or client. The second one is public or cloud system. So let's create our public and private key pairs and encrypt the bit information with our public key. If we use this encryption key, we will get 2 for the encrypted version of the bit. If we do the same arithmetic operation for the 8, we will get 126. If we send these 2 encrypted data to an encrypted bit and encrypted bit to the cloud, let's say there is a Aria Solver services in the cloud system. Aria Solver will multiply these 2 integer and get 252. And send it to the client again. So if we decrypt this value, we will get 21, which is exactly the same with the plain multiplication of the width and height. This is the example demonstration. So there are a lot of example of the homomorphic encryption-based cloud computing systems. There is a Horizon 2020 project, SMILE, which I am a researcher in this project. In this project, we are building a fully homomorphic encryption-based biometric authentication system for the fingerprint and iris-based authentication protocols. We used Microsoft SEAL-based homomorphic encryption libraries to implement our cryptographic protocol. As you see in the figure, the encrypted version of the biometrics data are recorded in the public cloud system. In order to authorize a people or person, we are using the homomorphic encryption-based cryptographic protocol to authorize the people to use our system in this project. Okay, there are other use cases. The most suitable use case, I guess, medical records or health technologies. You can analyze a disease or treatment without disclosing any patient information using homomorphic encryption. Also, you can search DNA markers without without revealing the DNA itself. Also, you can use homomorphic encryption in spam filtering, biometric matching, etc. But let's move to the types of the homomorphic encryption. There are three different types of homomorphic encryption. partially, somewhat, and fully homomorphic encryption. In fact, homomorphic encryption is an umbrella term, like machine learning. So machine learning itself is not an algorithm, it's an umbrella term. There are some algorithms under the machine learning term. The same rule applies in here. Homomorphic encryption is an umbrella term. There are lots of algorithms which implements the homomorphic properties in arithmetic operations. So let's start with the partial homomorphic encryption. Partial homomorphic encryption, you can use it when you can only perform some certain arithmetical operation over the encrypted data. As I said, there are lots of crypto systems, but the most used partial homomorphic encryption crypto systems, the first one is RSA. By using RSA crypto system, which is partially homomorphic with respect to multiplication, you can multiply to encrypted data, but you cannot add to encrypted data. The most popular partial homomorphic encryption crypto system is PyLAR. PyLAR is an additive homomorphic encryption crypto system. So you can add two encrypted data. You can multiply one encrypted and one plain data, but you cannot multiply the two encrypted data using PyLAR crypto system. So let's continue with the somewhat homomorphic encryption. Somewhat homomorphic encryption is the more general than partial homomorphic encryption in the sense. It supports homomorphic encryption with additions and multiplication. But the drawback is that you can perform only limited number of homomorphic encryption. And the last one is full homomorphic encryption. So if you are using full homomorphic encryption, you can perform mathematical operation on the shifter text. For example, you can add, subtract, multiply two encrypted data. And also you can add one encrypted, one plane. You can subtract one encrypted, one plane. And you can multiply one encrypted and one plane data using full homomorphic encryption. So there are some notes. Okay, there are some open sources. There are some open source libraries for the homomorphic encryption. The most popular homomorphic encryption libraries are, the first one is Microsoft Seal. The second one is IBM Haley. Both of them are based on the C++ implementation. There are some Python wrappers you can use it, use them in your Python code. On the other hand, these libraries are very complicated. It is not easy to implement some cryptographic protocols in your applications. So there is another library, PyPL. PyPL, in fact, itself is not a homomorphic encryption library. Instead, it simplifies the development process of the Microsoft Seal and IBM Haley. If you are familiar with the machine learning, as you know, there are two different libraries. The first one is Keras, the second one is TensorFlow. The development of TensorFlow or TensorFlow-based development is not an easy job because it's very complicated. So in order to simplify the TensorFlow implementation, there's another library, Keras. People generally use Keras library to simplify the TensorFlow-based solutions. Keras itself, again, is not a deep learning library. At the backend, it uses the TensorFlow. The same rule applies in here. PyPL is not a homomorphic encryption library, but it simplifies the Microsoft Seal or IBM Haley based developments. Okay, let me continue with the privacy preserving area solver implementation this time. As you remember, there was a demonstration of to calculate the privacy preserving manner rectangle area calculation. So in order to compute the privacy preserving area solver using the pie field, there will be four different sections. The first one is key generation, as you see in here. The second one is client encryption. Client encrypt the height and bit information using the encryption object. And then cloud computation, cloud or cloud server will multiply these two encrypted data to get the encrypted version of them, to get the encrypted version of the rectangle area. And then the client decrypt the encrypted area to find the area of the rectangle. As you see, it is again 21, which is exactly the same, the plain version multiplication of the height and width. So it's very easy to implement by using the PyPI. If you are, if you want to use the homomorphic encryption, you should use this library. Okay, let's continue with the homomorphic encryption applications. The most used area is privacy preserving machine learning. Privacy preserving machine learning considers the problem running on the algorithms on sensitive data that is not supposed to be shared even even to party running the algorithm. So you can use homomorphic encryption and secure machine learning methods to build a privacy preserving algorithms. There is a proof of concept implementation for the privacy preserving machine learning approach, which is called as CryptoNet, which is developed by the Microsoft research. In this approach, there are three entities. The first one is machine learning developer, as you see in here, the data owners, and untrusted cloud. As I said, this proof of concept implementation, you can access the source code using the GitHub Microsoft CryptoNet. This is a full homomorphic encryption based deep learning using the Microsoft SQL library. Okay, the last section is in my presentation is order preserving encryption. As you know, there's a new concept with the cloud computing, database as a service. Order preserving encryption is an encryption system whose encryption function preserves the numerical ordering of the plain text. It allows compression operation to be directly applied on the encrypted data without decrypting the operands. So you can use the, some SQL queries with this encryption system. You can use max, min, count, or group by or order by. To use some and average keyword or a function, you need to use also a homomorphic encryption. This is an example table. If y is bigger than x, then encrypted version of the y is bigger than x if you are using the order preserving encryption. For the order preserving encryption, there are some libraries, open source libraries. I guess the most popular library is PyOp. You can freely download from the internet. And let's try to create an order preserving encryption based database. So let's say we have a table with name and salary. There is an error in this graph. I should remove the encrypted salary at the beginning. Let's think that there are only two columns, name and the salary. Okay, let's continue. By using PyOp, order preserving encryption, it's similar to homomorphic encryption. We need to generate a crypto object. After creating an object, in this example, I create an in-memory database and I create a table, user table, with a three column, usernames, text, salaries integer, and salaries encrypt integer. I create 10 random record for this table. And this is the our final table. As you see, I am using the standard SQL queries to find to get the records from the database. So this unordered version. So maybe we can use order by queries in this database. Select from user table, order by salaries, encrypted. So if I execute this SQL query in this database, as you see, the output of the table is ordered by the salary. It's as you see in this example, I didn't change any database. Database internal implementations. I used the standard database engine, SQLite engine, and I used the standard SQL queries to query the data or manipulate the data. I change only the data itself. That's the end of my presentation. Hopefully, I was able to provide enough information about privacy techniques in the literature. As I said, my purpose in this presentation is to give the implementation methods generally. I hope it was useful to you. Now we can move to questions section if you have. Thank you for listening.
Open chat section. Okay, is there any question? Is there any question? As I see, there's no question.
I hope everything is clear.
Yes, I think so. Thank you for our thanks to our audience for joining us today with our third webinar with IEEE experts with Region 8, and thank you for your valuable information and presentation, Dr. Shatak. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for your invitation.
So see you in our next webinar series. Please keep joining us.
Okay, thanks.
Good night. Okay, to everyone.
Bye-bye.